How could you even tell what's on?
I can tell.
Yeah, back.
Too late,
I'm
in the 40s. Gotta go around the horn. Faster.
Hi, I'm John Lasseter, director of Toy Story and Toy Story 2. And we're here at Pixar Animation Studios. This is the studio in these humble buildings where we made Toy Story, A Bug's Life, and Toy Story 2. Now, today, we get to present to you the DVD collection of Toy Story and Toy Story 2 together. Now, for the first time, seems like we do a lot of firsts at Pixar, but the first time, you get all of the making of material for both movies, Toy Story and Toy Story 2, together. And now they're connected together because some of the ideas that we had in this. Guys, where are you going? Where are you going?
We're
doing the introductions of the DVD right now.
Oh.
You guys are going to help me, remember?
That's now?
Yeah. Yeah, some of these guys are going to be helping me with the introductions of the DVD. They're really great. Now, this is Lee Unkrich, who co-directed. This is Lee Unkrich, who co-directed Toy Story 2 with me. Now, the other co-director is Ash Brannon, right here. Ash. Yeah, this is Ash Brannon. He's going to do some introductions, too. Now, the guy who seems to write everything for Pixar and all our Pixar films, Andrew Stanton, he's going to help, too. This is Andrew Stanton. So it's going to be really great because, you know, some of the ideas in Toy Story 2 we actually came up with in Toy Story 1. And the materials, you're going to see them connected together and you're going to be able to go back and forth and stuff for the first time. It's really, really cool. This DVD is awesome. Wait till you see it. Okay, now this is going to be great. Okay, come on, guys. Come on, we got to go. This is going to be great. Come on, DVDs. It's up for a DVD. We love DVDs. Come on. It's going to be fun. Here, Andrew, you get to say super genius all the time like a Bugs Life. Remember, this is gonna be fun. Woo! I'm having fun. This is gonna be great. This is gonna be great.
And away we go.
Thank you.
what you're doing.
I'm Tempest from Mars.
Yeah, what's this button? Say, you weren't thinking of flying, were you?
Well,
you know Andy loves toys that can fly.
Really? Well then, to infinity and beyond.
You know, Andy loves toys that he can find.
What's following is the original treatment, the original pitch of Toy Story. You'll notice that this is doesn't even resemble the final movie, except in a few cases. But you will definitely see some elements that were not used in Toy Story, but were used in Toy Story 2. We believe that a good idea will always find its way to a surface at some point in time.
This is a test that was animated by Andrew Stanton. He can tell his design has gone through a couple changes. His body is scaled differently. He's got a totally different face. Notice he's got two holsters. This was a test that was animated back before Tom Hanks had signed. We were trying to convince Tom to throw his hat in the ring with us. And apparently he liked it.
Oh, no, you're eating the car! Don't eat the car! I got the car! Oh, you stupid fuck!
This is another test that Andrew Stanton did. Quick draw. Nice. And again, it's physically believable, good weight shifts, but it also tells you a lot about Woody's character. It really communicates a lot about who Woody is. This is a test that was animated by Pete Docter, and this was a preliminary version of Buzz. You see his face is kind of similar, but his body is much, much, much smaller than the original Buzz. The color's different. The helmet's different. He's got funny wings. The runs that Pete's doing here are probably different than they would be if he had been using the new Buzz, the Buzz we're all familiar with. This is a test that John Lasseter animated. How about that? That doesn't happen too often. And again, this is just a character study of Buzz. At one point, they were wondering, you know, what would it be like if Billy Crystal did the voice of Buzz? So they grabbed a line from a Billy Crystal movie and animated this test. Looks great.
In computer animation, you get nothing for free. Every object you see on the screen has to be created from scratch. And the way it starts is we start with blueprints. We call them model packs, that an object is designed. And then that's given to a modeler. And they create the model within the computer. This is how we created the box that Buzz Lightyear came in.
Basically, I get a model packet from the art department, like this one here, for the Buzz box, and once it's approved and everything, I get it and I build it. So I'll just start from scratch, and I might scan in one of his drawings just for shape reference or size or various sort of things, and use it as a template, and I'll start building curves and surfaces and shapes in 3D and start building, in this case, a box. I sculpt it, put it together until we get the right shape and it's approved. Then I'll pass this model on to another piece of software where I'll add animation variables for controlling, in this case, flaps and other things on this model. And after that's approved, the model is basically finished, and I'll pass it on to whoever adds the shading and texture maps, which the art department has designed to be placed on this thing. And then we have a final sort of a rendered version of this box. And it's approved, and then it goes on to layout and lighting.
My ship! Blast. This will take weeks to repair.
This is not a particularly, from an animation point of view, there's not a tremendous amount happening in these tests. It's really what we call it a spin test, for obvious reasons, since there's so much spinning going on. And it's really just for the technical folks to show the directors what the hair is going to look like. What we're doing is we're just going through all of the facial controls from the neck up on Sid, one by one, just to ensure that they work.
We've taken a sculpture of the dog, which is made for the purposes of capturing the shape, and we sample points along the surface of the dog, and from those sample points we fit a mathematical surface that we can then animate, add the surface descriptions that make the rest of the film happen. There's a lot of planning. I spent about a week planning out where I should sample him. And then from that, I spend maybe 2 or 3 days digitizing each major part of his body, 2 days on the body and probably 3 or 4 on the head, and then several days kind of taking all that data and fitting it together with the program I have here so that all the parts of the body blend smoothly and he doesn't look like he has any holes or gaps in him.
So what do you have to do? He hasn't been final yet.
Scott hasn't.
So this is his final moment.
Oh, wow.
Well, let's see. I mean, to be honest, there isn't a whole lot that's done except kind of tweaking the animation controls. Peter wanted to know whether you really wanted the jaw to hinge way back there, and I told him you did. I told him, yes, you wanted that, you liked that. I liked it. He better like it.
Did you see the run cycle?
No, I haven't shown him the run cycle.
Yeah, see, this is the thing. We're looking at the MyBridge stuff, you know, and looking at the real extension.
Uh-huh.
See mm-hmm. how, when you compare how thin it kind of mm-hmm. gets in here. Because he looks like a puppy almost, you know.
Uh-huh.
Look at the tail, though. The tail works great.
Yeah. Happy Scud?
Scud's never happy.
This is a great test of Scud running. Nice and dynamic, physically believable. All these tests that you're seeing, this is how we work on our animation system. And you know, I notice things don't look very pretty, but they have the same mass that they do when they're rendered with lighting and shadows and whatnot. This is an early test for Mom. From an animation point of view, it's a little wonky, but again, it does what it needs. This is a test for hair. She's got that awesome, I don't know what that is, looks like she dipped her head in some man-made material. This looks sort of like varnished wood. And there's this kind of super weird, stringy-looking outer layer. It gets even worse, even stringier. But when you put them all together, you actually get a fairly realistic, pretty decent-looking head of hair on Mom. Looks like she's still a little heavy on the hairspray, but doesn't look too bad.
This is Andy's room, late afternoon, and it's after Buzz Lightyear has gotten here, so you can see kind of the Buzz posters and the Buzz Lightyear comforter on Andy's bed. And if you look very carefully at the book titles, if you've seen some of the other Pixar short films, you'll probably recognize a few of the names. If not the title of the film itself, then certainly if you look at the credits, you'll see other people's names on there. One thing that was really hard to do when we started this was try and find a way to caricature the world and shapes in the world. The one thing about lighting and texturing that we do here is it really does bring it back more into a really believable world. And so caricatured shapes, if the whole world isn't caricatured, that tends to work not as well. So this is the Dynaco gas station in Andy's neighborhood. You can see it's kind of a little brontosaurus in the logo. What we always wanted to do was kind of a 50s style leftover gas station in the neighborhood. And so we got a little bit of that. And we also wanted to get the really harsh fluorescent lighting. It's kind of got a blue tinge to it and just very harsh and very exposing. You can see things like little oil stains and tire tracks and oil can stand there. So if you look here too, some of the things we always struggled with were getting that cheesy cement rock texture on this trash can right here. If you look also inside the lobby of the gas station, you can see a few things like potato chips, and it's actually all there. So there's a lot of detail that sometimes you see in the background. Sometimes we wish we had spent more time on the things we do see than the stuff we really don't see. But the film changes so often and so fast in story that it's hard to keep up with that. Still, I think that it looks pretty good, and I'm pretty proud of it. We had a great art department on this film. This is Sid's room, and there's things like, in the final film, there's underwear and socks hanging out of the dresser. And then if you look very carefully, you can see a waffle iron there with a baby smushed in it, little toy doll. And there's a really great poster up there, Killing Paul Bunyan and his Blue Ox of Doom. The shooting target is actually one from layout artist Craig Good's office he's had hanging up. You can see how well he keeps his room locked. And there's just lots of junk laying around. We modeled a few things like cans and tapes and cups for other purposes in the film, and we needed it for set dressing, so we would sprinkle it throughout the room. One of the things that's really hard to do with the computer with a computer film is to really get the sense that it's a real space and not just kind of a cold environment. We were able to utilize little bits and pieces from all over the film and kind of cram it into Sid's room so that it looked like a mess.
story. S-T-O-R-Y. Story. Story.
Hey, we're here in the story department with head of story extraordinaire, Joe Rampt. Hi, Joe. Say hi.
Hi.
Now, we're going to explain to you exactly how we just create story. We usually start with the written word, and I'll write something. And then once I think it's good enough, I ask for see if John likes it and approves it. Yeah, it's great! Approved! And he gives it to Joe, as you can see. And then what exactly do you do with it, Joe?
Well, I take the written word and I draw it into pictures. And then I take those pictures and I pin them to a board, a storyboard like this. And then after that's done, I pitch it to the directors.
Okay, now why exactly do you pitch them to the director?
Well, I want to give a sense of what this movie could be like. So it's like telling a story to your friends and try to bring it to life and get a feeling of what the story could be like on a, as a final film.
Oh, so it's what it would feel like to be in the theater watching the movie.
Trying to convey that feeling to people.
So what are we going to see now?
Right now, you're going to see me pitching the Army Man sequence from the first Toy Story. And by the way, this was the very first sequence ever storyboarded on Toy Story 1.
Yep, it was.
Story. Story.
Now let's all be nice and say hello to our new friend.
The air is...
Yeah!
Story. Story.
In the development of our films, especially Toy Story, we go down a lot of wrong paths.
A lot.
We develop the stories that we think are absolutely perfect. These sequences are just genius. We look at them on the script, great. We storyboard them, they're fantastic. Yeah. We look at them on a story reel, they stink. We're gonna show you these abandoned sequences, or more appropriately, our mistakes. And there's a lot of really great ones here that we really love. The Buzz Lightyear cartoon, there's an alternate opening for Toy Story where it's more of a fantasy sequence of Andy's. There's a great Woody's Nightmare, which is actually something that ended up in Toy Story 2. And there's that one sequence that you always talked about that actually, in a weird way, became the theme of Toy Story 2. Little sequence starring Shakes the Rattle.
Yeah, we had this whole character named Shakes the Rattle who was one of Andy's baby toys, and all the toys kind of gathered around and heard the story about what happened to Shakes the Rattle because he was abandoned and lost, and lo and behold, that ended up becoming the whole central theme of Toy Story 2.
Yep.
Yeah. So here is a bunch of our mistakes.
Story.
This is where we're going to explain the animation process of how we make films here at Pixar. This is a scene from Toy Story 1. This is when Buzz and Woody first meet. Now, the first stage is the storyboard stage, and you'll see the drawings, still drawings done for the scene. It's kind of like a comic book version.
All right, that's enough. Look, we're all very impressed with Andy's new toy.
Toy?
T-O-Y, toy.
Excuse me, I think the word you're searching for is Space Ranger.
This next step is the layout phase of production. Once the storyboards and the models are ready, they come into layout. This is where we first build the film on the computer, our first step into 3D. There's no performance yet, that's what the animators do. Here we concern ourselves with the basic composition and blocking of the film.
All right, that's enough. Look, we're all very impressed with Andy's new toy.
Toy?
T-O-Y. Toy.
Excuse me, I think the word you're searching for is Space Ranger.
The next step in the process is animation. And this is where the animators take the story ideas and the layout and really bring the characters to life. And this is where they take good story ideas and truly make them great with their really amazing performances.
All right, that's enough. Look, we're all very impressed with Andy's new toy.
Toy?
T-O-Y, toy.
Excuse me, I think the word you're searching for is Space Ranger.
This is the final stage in the production. This is when we've taken the animation and we've added the shading and the lights to it. And this is where everything comes together and we get the final images.
All right, that's enough. Look, we're all very impressed with Andy's new toy.
Toy?
T-O-Y, toy.
Excuse me, I think the word you're searching for is Space Ranger.
In this section, we're going to be looking at a series of progression images, and these progression images are going to be showing us the shading and lighting, how we build our shaders, the surfaces on the models, as well as how we build our lighting our environments, as well as lighting our characters. Really, what we want to look at here is the color, the texture, and the emotion that all of this color and light add to our scenes. So in particular with the shading, you're going to see a buildup of textures that not only put surfaces on our models, but they're also adding an organic sense. They add dirt, they add scratches, they add a sense of something being real. And then with our lights, we're going to see the lighting of our environments, but in particular, you'll also see lighting of our characters, building the lights, adding rim lighting and key lighting to our characters that really give them a sense of being in the environment, but also help pull them away from the background so that you can really see them, so that your eye is focused in on the character.
And another thing, stop with this spaceman thing. It's getting on my nerves.
Okay, so we're going to start off with the progression reel here. Everything starts with story. So these are the storyboards that have been scanned in and put together by editorial, working out the timing and the pacing of our shot. And then after that's done, we go into layout. Now the set's already been built by set dressing, but layout first is going to go in there with the camera. This is the initial composition, just sort of blocking out where the camera should be for the duration of the shot. And here's the character blocking, so all of the beats that the characters have to hit over the course of the shot. But no real expression or real animation yet. Now you have the animation, and we have our basic colors in there, but we don't actually have our surface textures yet. So we have all of the expression, all of the animation, but none of the shading. Now here's the shading, but none of the lighting. So we actually, you can see the textures, all the textures on Woody, you know, the differences in the surface, some are cloth, some are plastic, all of that is done. But then the actual, that mood and ambience, pulling the characters from the background, giving everything its real shape, that's all done in lighting here, for the background and for the characters.
Where's that bonding strip? And another thing, stop with this spaceman thing. It's getting on my nerves.
What we're about to look at is the chase sequence from the first Toy Story. Now, this section, we get to see it three different ways.
First, you get to see the storyboard version.
It was a long one.
It was one of the longest sequences we ever boarded for the film. It was like 10 big boards long. But it worked. It worked great. And then the second level you're going to see is
the layout section. And this is where you'll see all the camera work. There's no animation in it yet. The character's just kind of stiff, you know. But we plan out the whole action that way.
But you'll see it in the computer there. And then the third level will be the final version, sort of the movie version that you remember seeing.
Right.
But the cool thing about this is that you're going to be
DVDs.
Able to go through all those while you're simultaneously watching it in real time.
Right.
So what you need to do is you need to get your DVD remote. Okay? Then you need to find out where your angle button is.
Right there.
Okay? And then you're gonna ride, baby! You're gonna
ride!
Okay?
Woo!
While you're playing it, you're just gonna keep clicking it, going from story to layout, to like final, to layout, to story, back to final, whatever you want to. It's so cool!
Nope.
looks good, though.
Yes.
It looks really good. It looks
very realistic. Realistic.
You might want to move the spray up above where you're shooting.
Sid Phillips reporting. Sid Phillips reporting. Sid Phillips reporting.
Are you all right? I'm proud of you, Sheriff. A lesser man would have talked under such torture. Are you all right? I'm proud of you, Sheriff. A lesser man would have talked under such torture. Are you all right? I'm proud of you, Sheriff. A lesser man would have talked under such torture.
Command to Buzz Lightyear. Come in, Buzz.
Meeting adjourned.
Meeting adjourned.
Nope.
Top of the world, living high, it was right in my pocket. I was
Before I was one of the co-directors of Toy Story 2, I was actually one of the editors of the original Toy Story movie. One of the most difficult decisions that an editor ever has to make, especially on one of our films here at Pixar, is cutting out animation that's already been completed. Because the animation is so expensive and time-consuming, and the animators really just pour their hearts into a lot of this stuff, we really try not to cut any of it out of the film. But unfortunately, occasionally we do need to. The first scene is a scene with Sid, right after Pizza Planet, when Sid has first brought Buzz and Woody back to his house. And the way we originally conceived the scene, we had this whole thing where Sid was torturing Buzz and Woody really pretty violently. And we ultimately decided to just cut into the scene right when Sid is interrogating and to remove all the kind of torturing stuff at the beginning. And the main reason we did that was we realized that our audience was going to be loving Buzz and Woody at this point, and the last thing they really wanted to see was them getting completely beaten up and tortured. The other scene that we didn't really cut out of the movie, but we shortened quite a bit, was the scene at night in Sid's bedroom when it's raining and Woody is trapped under the milk crate and trying to get Buzz's attention. The scene was originally much longer than what's in the final film. And at the time that we made the cuts, we made them because we were worried that the scene was playing too long and was just kind of losing the energy of the movie. Now that it's a few years later, looking back, we actually kind of regret that we made a lot of the cuts because we think that it was a really effective emotional scene and it probably could have stood up in the film as is. But you can decide for yourself when you watch the scene.
This is Andy's room. That's all I wanted to say. All right, that's enough. Look, we're all very impressed with Andy's new toy.
Toy? Excuse me, I think the word you're searching for is Space Ranger.
Doesn't he realize that I'm not there? I'm lost. Oh, the lost toy.
Here and you just tell the nice toys that you're not dead. Buzz Lightyear, you are not worried, are you?
Me? No.
Large box. It's.
Are you?
Now, Buzz, what could Andy possibly get that is worse than you?
Oh, what is it? Wow, a puppy!
You are clear to enter. Welcome to Beast Planet.
The white zone is for eating pizza only.
Jones, Cardium 5, your shuttle is now boarding at launch gate 12.
You are clear to enter. You are clear to enter. You are clear to enter. You are cleared 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 to enter.
When we came up with the original idea of Toy Story, about the notion of toys being alive, the original pitch was, it seems like, so far from what the final Toy Story was. But throughout the development, from that original pitch through to the final product, there was so many great ideas that came out of it. You know, a lot of them made it into the first Toy Story, but a lot of them didn't. We always believed that a good idea will always find its
No!
That one didn't age quite so well.
One of the
What's following is the original treatment, the original pitch of Toy Story. So the sequence is the...
It's showtime!
All right, all right!
Part of superb. Tom Hanks as Woody. What can you say? It's amazing.
This is a test where we're trying to figure out if we actually want to have Jesse, if we want to animate her hair. We chose not to do that. Here's a sassy little walk with Jesse. Jesse's body is actually Woody's body with a couple small changes, a couple scaling changes, and a totally different head. This is a walk where we're actually trying to define her character with a walk. Here's Bullseye running, and it's a nice physically believable run. It also, you know, communicates a little something about Bullseye's playful nature. This is just a sort of a general pose test for Bullseye. He's just running through a couple emotions, just making sure that he works. Often we'd think of Bullseye as almost like a big floppy dog. So one of the animators animated Bullseye lying down, just like a big floppy dog would, and it works really well. Here's Bullseye getting up. Again, it says a little something about his character, and it's also, you know, physically pretty believable. At some point, we weren't sure whether or not Bullseye would actually have to speak, whether he'd have a speaking role or not, so we had to make sure that if he did need to speak, he'd be able to, so we did a couple little dialogue tests. This shot with Bullseye's saddle falling down, John liked this test so much, he actually wrote it into the film. Again, here's another little Bullseye talking test. Oddly enough, I don't think his mouth is moving. looking at some Al tests. Al was a pretty interesting character to animate. He had a tremendous amount of mass and tiny little short legs. We actually looked at a lot of Danny DeVito in Romancing the Stone as reference. He's another little short, massive fellow.
Prepare to die. Hey, give me back my power module.
Nope.
The color script is a drawing, generally a fairly loose drawing, in color, that is intended to give the lighting artists a clear idea of what they need to do to make the shot look the way the director wants it to look. If you step through the upcoming color scripts that you have available to you, you'll be able to see the way the movie progresses in terms of color, atmosphere, mood, and it's a great opportunity to really see how the film is built from pieces of artwork all the way through the process into the final piece. So it's a great thing to enjoy. This is the turnaround of the planet that Zurg lives on, where his evil lair is that Buzz lands on. And the great thing about this is that you're able to see in greater detail than you can see in the film the elements that went into making this. This is actually a set that was created for A Bug's Life and was re-shaded and relit for to create Zurg's planet. So what you're really looking at is the set from the riverbed, the dry riverbed on Ant Island. This is Andy's new bedroom. The best way to tell it from Andy's old bedroom is that the wallpaper is entirely different. It's no longer the cloud wallpaper. It's the stars, which we designed as kind of a nod to both Woody's Sheriff Star and Buzz Lightyear's home in the stars. So it's kind of a double duty wallpaper there. It's basically the same layout as Andy's old room, with a couple of shifts in windows and a little bit more space on the floor to have the action that we needed in the movie. This is Andy's neighborhood. It's his new neighborhood because at the end of Toy Story, Andy had a brand new house and a brand new room. A lot of the stuff that you're seeing was, especially for the trees and rocks and bushes, were actually built for Bug's Life, and we were able to use them in Toy Story 2 as part of our digital backlot. The garage sale was also a great place to use old props that were built for some for Toy Story, the original Toy Story. Everything you see in any movie that we make at Pixar, and Toy Story 2 is no exception, has to be designed and built specific to the movie. This is the display room where Al keeps and displays his collectibles. And in this case, for most of the movie, it's the Woody's Roundup collection that you see on the shelves here. The display cases that house the different characters and all the wonderful pieces that we did for the Roundup collection. The TV is based on an old Philco TV. So everything here is based on Hopalong Cassidy and Howdy Doody type collectibles. This is the downtown where Al's building is and Al's Toy Barn is, right across the street. We originally had this as 5 blocks that led up to Al's building and about 13 blocks that led away from Al's building for the original chase. And when script changes came along, we literally picked up Al's Toy Barn from the suburbs where it used to live and planted it right across the street from Al's building. So Al's building is the large brown sort of gold brick building that he lives in, kind of an Art Deco piece. This is a wonderful overhead shot of the interior of Al's toy barn. And in this shot, you can see actually much better than you can in the film and the designs that went into the original packaging for the toys in the shelves at the toy barn. These are all, with the exception of the Barbie packaging, these are all original designs for toys that don't exist except in Al's toy barn. And Al's toy barn is basically a huge toy emporium, sort of a somewhat cheap warehouse set in the city that Andy lives in. This is the Buzz aisle where Buzz Lightyear finds himself looking at hundreds of versions of himself fresh in their mint boxes. He also finds the newest version of himself up on this very elaborate display featuring Buzz's new accessory, which is the utility belt that that Buzz grabs and turns out to be very handy later on, not for Buzz, but for the imposter Buzz or the replacement Buzz that leads the toys into Al's building. This is the Barbie aisle, the pink aisle, featuring scans of actual Barbie packaging that that were texture mapped onto the box models themselves to make this look as authentic as possible as a Barbie aisle. And then the tableau of dancing Barbies, the go-go Barbies with their little Barbie pool set and Barbie barbecue, were fairly fanciful, but we wanted to make it very elaborate so that it stopped the toys dead in their tracks and got tour guide Barbie to give them some information. We're looking at an interior turnaround of Al's office in the toy barn, where the toys, led by Buzz, go to look to see if they can find Woody, who they think is in this office with all the boxes and the toys in the background. You can see in this turnaround, there are some clear shots of some of the package designs that we did for Al's toy barn that you probably won't see out in the regular toy barn. One of my favorites to look for is the Toss the Cop a Donut package and the three French Impressionist action figure packages as well. You'll be able to see those clearly in Al's office. This is the exterior shot of the Tri-County International Airport, where the toys pull up in the Pizza Planet truck and find a way to get inside to find Woody, who's on his way to Tokyo on a plane, sort of based on various airport designs from the late 50s on into the late 70s, a nice conglomeration of it, with a beautiful control tower in the background that's not unlike a giant salt and pepper shaker. This is the interior of the terminal of the airport. We're right in front of the desk for Far East Airlines, where Al has to check in his bag that contains the Roundup Gang on their way, he thinks, to the Tokyo Museum. Beautiful sky flat in the background painted by Randy Barrett, and the sparse population of humans walking around to make the terminal look realistically filled with people, even though it's late at night, probably about 9:30 or 10 o'clock at night.
Hi, I'm Joe Ranft.
And I'm Dan Jupe.
And together we're
co-head of story
on Toy Story 2. Now pay attention, because this can get a little confusing. What you're going to see now is a story pitch of the nightmare sequence from Toy Story 2.
And interesting fact, we boarded a sequence for Toy Story 1 of a nightmare that didn't work, so we cut it, and we decided to use it in Toy Story 2.
Now, if you want to see the deleted nightmare from Toy Story 1, go to the Toy Story 1 section. And also, there's another Woody nightmare on the Toy Story treat, so you get three nightmares for the price of one.
So now that you got that all worked out, Joe Ranft is going to pitch the nightmare sequence from Toy Story 2.
And we hope you like it.
Now you're about to see a storyboard to final film comparison of the Jesse's song sequence. If you use your angle feature at home, you can click on two different versions of the storyboard. One will show you the story sketch next to the final film so you can watch it together. And if you press your angle feature, you'll be able to see just the full frame of the story sketch. Now the interesting thing about storyboarding is that it is the blueprint of the film, so everything that you see in the story sketch pretty much is what the final film will be. All the acting, the camera angles, the basic plan of the film. Check it out, and we hope you like it.
You are going to see something really, really cool. It is the opening sequence of Toy Story 2. This actually has its origins back in Toy Story 1. If you look back in that section, you'll see an abandoned sequence of the Buzz Lightyear opening cartoon. In this section, actually, of the DVD, this is extremely cool. Is it, we have, how many versions of this do we have?
You're going to be able to see the storyboards, you're going to be able to see the layout, you're going to be able to see the animation before we put any of the textures or the lighting in, and then you're going to be able to see the final version with all the lighting.
That is cool.
And you're going to be able to switch them.
How?
Well,
with your remote. Ha! So get your remote, and that's going to guide you from each section to each section while it's playing in real time.
Woo!
Use that angle button.
Buzz Lightyear mission log. All signs point to this planet as the location of Zurg's fortress, but there seems to be no sign of intelligent life anywhere. Huh?
Hi, we're in one of the screening rooms here at Pixar. And in this room, we look at a lot of the films in various stages of production. And we want to show you right now a couple of scenes we had to delete from Toy Story 2. The first, Godzilla Rex. And for the story, it served as a means to get Woody to the yard sale.
In this section of the DVD, we're going to present the elevator shaft Buzz Lightyear Emperor Zurg fight scene in a way for you to listen to the different elements of the soundtrack and hear them individually. The dialogue, the sound effects, and the music are available to you on a simplified version of a console like mine, and so you can choose to listen to any of those elements, and you can also choose to listen to the final mix.
Oh. Wait, so is my DVD just about the music?
So, we meet again, Buzz Lightyear.
Bobbit! Watch out! He's got an ion blaster!
Huh? Oof! Ah!
No!
Buzz Lightyear, for the last time.
Bobbit Zurg! Watch out! He's got an ion blaster!
Hi, we're in one of the screening rooms here at Pixar, and in this room we look at a lot of the films in various stages of the production, and we want to show you right now a couple of scenes we had to delete from Toy Story 2. The first sequence we're going to look at is called Godzilla Rex, and for the story it served as a means to get Woody to the yard sale, where he had to be kidnapped, but it turned out to be way too coincidental, and that's why we changed the story and reanimated. And the second scene we're going to look at is crossing the road. And it wasn't deleted as much as it was just moved to a different location. It was originally in the suburbs, but it worked much better if Al's toy barn was right across from Al's penthouse. So we put it right in the middle of the city.